What I would like to do today, together with you, is to examine a few questions. And the first of these questions is, how do we teach science? And I would like to do that with a little play. I will assume that you are not science students, but literature students. And I will, for a while, not be a science teacher. I will put up the hat of a literature teacher. I'm teaching to you a course on Flemish literature. So I will enter the class again, being a literature teacher. So good morning, class. The lecture of today will be about a famous Flemish author called Willem Elschot, and more in particular about one of his most famous novels called Kaas, Cheese. Any connotation between this title and the country in which we are is purely coincidental. I assume you have your copy of the book with the novel on your desk, so you can open it with me on page 433, which is the first page of this novel. And please read with me, in the original language, of course. Eindelijk schrijf ik je weer, omdat er grote dingen staan te gebeuren. Toen had zij het gemerkt en warempel gezegd, die zijn al geschild. And so the lecture goes on for 1.5 hours. Do you think that literature is taught in this way? Probably not. It would be quite ridiculous to teach literature in such a way. However, if we do science, if we teach science, then it's more or less like what I just demonstrated. Every student has a copy of the textbook on his or her desk. And what do? Either on the screen or on the blackboard, we just repeat that book. And in a way, that is as ridiculous as teaching literature in that way. Now, 1 week ago, I sent to most of you a questionnaire. And one of the first questions I asked you to answer was, what are your opinions about this way of lecturing, and why do you think we do it that way? Well, let me go through some of the answers that you provided. One answer that was very dominant was a rather historical version, a historical explanation. People said, well, if you have just your body, no technology, how do you communicate then knowledge that is in your head to other people? You group these other people around you and you talk about your knowledge. You lecture. Without any technology present, that's the most natural way to do. Even if you have some form of technology, say written texts, but written texts that are in precious handwritten books, even then, this form of sharing knowledge is very useful. Imagine somebody in the Middle Ages who has to teach about Aristotelian physics. Well, the professor goes to the university library, where you have the single copy of the physics of Aristotle. He brings that copy to the lecture room, opens it, and start reading the book. And in that way, the knowledge goes from the book to the audience. With that kind of technology, there is hardly any other way to do it. But since the Middle Ages, we invented printing in a mechanical way. We have radio, we have television, we have internet. So lots of things have changed. And still, the way of teaching we use is the way that uses the zero technology level. Why is that? Well, some of you call this inertia. We just do it because we have seen it done before us from our teachers, and they have seen it from their teachers, and that's a chain that goes back until the ancient Greek. Teaching is done this way because it always has been done that way. Another argument that some of you indicated was, well, this way of teaching is very easy and very cheap. It's very easy for the teacher because you can prepare your material and it's very predictable, very under control. You just deliver your story and you're done. And it's very cheap, because with one salary, you can teach 200, 300 students. That is probably also a reason why this way of lecturing is present. And there was one very nice argument that I didn't anticipate, and one of you wrote that one down. This way of lecturing is a way of protecting ourselves, because most of us have been educated by lecturing. If we would now admit that lecturing is not the best way of teaching, it would mean that our own education is not the best one that we could have got. So instinctively, we will defend that way of teaching. We protect ourselves and do not admit that we could even have been better if we would have had better teachers. Subconsciously, that's probably an argument that is playing a role as well. Now, this lecturing wouldn't be a problem if that would be a very efficient way of teaching. So let's examine this question: is lecturing efficient? I don't think it is, and I see two main problems with it. The first one I will illustrate by this little story. You see that I'm wearing this headset, and it is because I'm making a sound and screen recording of this lecture. And I started doing this some 2 years ago. In every conference presentation, I do the same. And I put this on YouTube so people can later watch these conference presentations again. And in the beginning, I was not very sure what the audience would think about me standing here with this silly thing on my head. So in the first minute of my presentation, I always told the people why this was. Now, do you know what was guaranteed the question I got in every conference presentation, either in the question and answer session or privately afterwards? Could you please explain why you were wearing this headset? I thought, come on, I have told this publicly why this was, but people didn't catch it. If that is true with such a very simple story, I'm wearing this headset because of, well, how much of the technical information does not come across? So one of the big problems with lecturing, traditional lecturing, is this information loss. I can tell anything I want, but you will remember only 10% of it. When you wake up tomorrow morning, you will have forgotten 90% of everything I told you here, unavoidably. There is a second disadvantage of this way of teaching, and there is another story to illustrate that one. One of my children was taking earlier this year a course in 10-finger typing, so blind typing with all the fingers of your hands. And the school uses some old laptops to teach the children this way of typing. And of course, when he was doing his exercises in the family, we talk about that. And one evening at the dinner table, we started telling stories when me and my wife were taking such courses many years ago. And we told the children, well, in our time, we were not using laptops to learn typing. We used typewriters. And they have never seen a typewriter in their life, so they asked us, what is that, a typewriter? And we explain, you put that paper inside, you have to roll, you press these buttons, the hammers are hitting some ribbon with ink, and you have to turn this carriage every line back and forth. They seem to understand, and everybody happy. The discussion goes on to other topics. A few minutes later, my son looked puzzled and he said, Daddy, I have still a question about this typewriter. Once you have finished all this typing, how do you then eventually print that letter? And at that moment, I realized that although it looked like he had understood the whole story, he hadn't got the point. Now, if he wouldn't have been asking me that question, I would never have realized that he had a problem in understanding. And at our family dinner table, it's very easy to ask questions. The threshold is low. But similar misunderstandings are happening in our lectures continuously. And the barrier for students to ask questions about what they don't understand is much higher in a lecture. We try to reduce that barrier, but you know, from the point of view of a student, that barrier is really there. So there is not only this information loss, there is also the problem that there are many misconceptions growing in the heads of our students, and we are simply not aware of these misconceptions. The most embarrassing thing is that all our students know that this way of teaching is very inefficient. And I realized that a few years ago when I got an email from one of my students. I will show it, and please read with me. The student was telling, well, I have an appointment, and that was fixed already a long time ago. I will not be able to attend the first lecture of your course that starts next week. Very polite student, no problem. The mail goes on. Do I miss something important? Well, at that moment, I realized how much value students put in a lecture. Imagine the student buying a book at Amazon, and he gets the book, and there is a short note inside the package. Well, due to a printing problem, the first chapter of this book is missing, but you don't miss anything important, and we still ask you the full price for it. For sure, that student would return the book, but for a lecture, it's acceptable. That means they see no value in that lecture. So we should improve this. Can we improve it? That's the next question. Well, let's go back to lecturing, but in an ideal world. And I'm sure that a story like I will tell you now is something many of you will have told to your students in the first lecture of a course. What do you expect from your students? We organize a set of weekly lectures. These are the green blocks there. And we ask our students in the evening at home, digest that lecture. Look back to your slides, look back to your notes, read some parts in your textbook, and digest it. And if you have questions, ask them to me the first minute of the next lecture. And that's very good advice, because it remediates all the problems about lecturing. If they do this study work in the evening, they will remember more. They move information from their short-term memory, that is rapidly decaying, to the long-term memory. And when they have problems and ask these problems to us, then we know what misconceptions are going on. So that should work perfectly fine. But you know what happens in the real world. Students would do something that looks much more like this. They don't digest the lectures in the evening. And once you are a few weeks into the semester, you ask a question to the room, and there is silence. Everybody is looking somewhere else in order not to be pointed to answer that question. They cannot answer the question anymore because they are completely lost about the material. But that's not a problem because you have this study period before the exam, and there you will really study everything and you will pass the exam. You will forget everything equally rapidly, but that's not their concern at that moment. The point about flipped classroom teaching is that you try to implement the top line, the effect you want in the real world, in the ideal world, you want to implement that in the real world. And the trick is, and you have probably heard about the principle before, you move the studying in front of the lectures. The red block comes first. Students should, in one way or another, and we will discuss how, should study the material. And instead of lecturing to them on the material, instead of reading the book, you will discuss about their problems. And in this way, you can have a very much smaller study period before the exams. That's the thing we will try to realize. A question that many of you inserted in your notes in the questionnaire was this big concern: what if the students don't prepare their class sessions, because then this whole system would immediately collapse. That's a valid concern, and you can immediately test that this is a valid one, because the questionnaire that I sent you was a kind of mild flipped classroom attempt. I used this questionnaire to build the lecture I'm giving now. So let's see how many of this very much motivated audience submitted a report to me. It turns out to be about 1/2 of you, which is a very fair number, but you are very motivated and enthusiastic. An average group of students would probably end up in 10 to 20%. So how can we avoid that this happens? And how can we make sure that we have a nearly 100% submitting of reports? There are a few tricks for that. One of them is that in the first lecture, I always make a very clear agreement with my students. I need your reports in order to make my lectures. That means if there is no report, there will be no lecture. As simple as that. If you want a lecture, you have to do something for it. I have never been so far in the situation where I really had to act that way. Just telling this seems to be sufficient, combined with the other tricks. The second trick, it's not really a trick, it's just human psychology. There is a kind of social pressure. Imagine that you are the one who did not submit a report, and you are sitting in this audience, and your neighbor suddenly bends over and says, look, there on the slide, that paragraph, that's from my report. Ah, he's using my paragraph. And then you see that many of the students in the room can start discussing about that particular paragraph, because they had prepared it as well. And you sit there not really knowing what is going on, not knowing how to behave. You will not do that a second time. Next time you will submit your report as well. So that simple psychology, once a sufficient number of students is submitting reports, that drags with them the others. And a third one is the power we have as educators to give grades. There is a golden rule about grading. You should award the points for those activities where you really want that students do them. So if submitting reports in a flipped classroom setting is important, you should award them for that. So I tell my students the first lecture of a course, right now, at this very moment, you get 4 out of the total of 20 points for this course for free. They are yours. Everybody happy. But there is a small condition. Every week you do not submit a report, you lose one of them. And that's a very effective strategy to make sure that until the very last week of the semester, students are submitting their reports. If you would fail 4 times to submit a report, then in the exam, if it is perfect, you can have only 16 out of 20, which is still a very good score, but you need a perfect exam for that. It's also important to tell them that I will not grade the content of the reports, because in these weeks of the semester, we are still in the learning phase. It's allowed to make mistakes. I will only grade the effort. As soon as your report is there, and as long as it is not obviously copied from some other report in my collection, then you keep having your points. And these three things together make that I have a report submission rate of close to 100%. It hardly ever happens that somebody does not submit a report. Let's imagine that you are now convinced that you want to give flipped classroom teaching a try. How could you convert your course to a flipped classroom format? Now, one of you in the questionnaire formulated it that way. I heard from some colleagues that it takes a huge amount of time to convert a course. So the real question is not how can you convert a course, but how can you convert that course efficiently? I have a four-step strategy for that. The starting point, which is probably true for many of you, is that you have a good collection of slides. Something you worked on for years, they have iterated, improved, and now you really have your perfect set of slides. And you don't want to lose that material. You invested so much effort in this, so you want to keep it. Well, one thing you can do is, before the new teaching semester starts, go through your slides and look at them from the point of view of short items, not slides for a 1.5 hour lecture, but how can you divide the slides in such a way that every block of, say, 5 to 10 minutes covers one specific question. Then you insert a title slide in front of each of these blocks, so that also visually your slide deck is reorganized such that it consists out of these 5 to 10 minute blocks. If you really have good slides, that will not take you too much time. That's just a different point, looking at them from a different point of view. Then you start teaching, and you do it in just the same way as you did it before. You lecture with that reshuffled set of slides, but you make a recording, either by the infrastructure that your university offers to you, or you use your own screencast material like I'm doing right now. That doesn't take you any extra effort. You just do it as you have done it all the years before. Then comes the somewhat harder step. You have to edit this raw video material into movies of 5 to 10 minutes. You have to take away these 5 to 10 minutes parts into separate movies. If there were some disturbances, students that were asking questions or somebody entering the room, you cut that away such that you have a neat condensed movie. That is the part of the work that takes time and effort. But the good news is that this is also the part of the work that you can outsource. You can ask a teaching assistant or a job student to do this conversion for you. Because you don't really have to know what is happening with the content of the lecture. It's just a mechanical process of making a nice video out of that. So this step again will not take you personally too much effort. And the fourth and also important step is, now you have to find for every of these short blocks one or more tasks or questions that probe whether the student has understood the basics of that short 5-minute video. Because you will offer the students not only the videos, but to every video should be a question connected, and the answer to the question, that is what will go into the report on which you will build your next lecture. If you know the contents of your course, also that should not be too hard a step. So if you go through that process with minimal effort, you have transformed in 1 year time your original set of slides into a set of movies, short movies, with a very similar content. The next question is immediately then, if you then go to a class where you will discuss these reports, what will happen then? I have done all my lecturing already. It's recorded, it's in the videos, they have seen it. So what is left to do in class? I have a few templates for this. Templates that you can immediately adapt to your own material. Let's imagine that you asked in connection to one of the videos, question A, whatever it is, depends on your topic. One of the students has written in his or her report an answer that you clearly see is wrong. Well, you cut out that answer, put it on your slide, and without telling the name of the student, of course, you say, well, this is an example of what one of you answered, and it's wrong because of that and that and that reason. So you can start discussing about the misconception of that student. Another student, you say, answered this thing here, which is not really wrong, but the argument that you use is irrelevant. And it is irrelevant because of, oops, and you are discussing the content again. And then several of you have answered this thing here, and that's the right answer. The key argument you should have used is this one. So in a very natural way, you are discussing the science of your course. And this is this particular template is a very safe one. It is almost as if you are lecturing in the normal way, but not about the textbook anymore, about the problems of your students. Another way to do it could be you take one answer and another answer that are different and ideally even opposite to each other. You show them both and you don't tell which one is the right one. Then you step aside for a few minutes and now it's up to the class to discuss among themselves and give arguments why one or the other answer that both come from this group would be the good one. So students start discussing science in the class. And you come to a conclusion. If they really would have a misconception, it will be corrected in front of the entire group. It could also happen that almost nobody gives the right answer. So that's then an indication that then you could tell them, well, I see that this is really a problem. So I see from your answers that this and this and this is going wrong. Well, I have devised an alternative explanation that will avoid these misunderstandings. Let me give here right now this alternative explanation and let's then try to see whether you understand it that way. It could also happen that somebody has inserted a specific question in the report. So once you come in your lecture at the point where that question is relevant, show it and either answer the question or discuss with the group to get the question answered. Or it could happen that a question was so easy that everybody has given the right answer. Well, no problem. Then you can go one step further and give them an exercise or a problem that builds upon that piece of material. So if you use these four simple templates and if you mix them according to your taste, you can easily build in 1-2 hours time a lecture that covers 1.5 hours. And a lecture that will not be a static one, one where you will have a lot of interaction with your students. Somebody asked in the questionnaire, well, tell me also about the don'ts of flipped classrooms. So what should you certainly avoid? And I've listed a few of them. Long videos. If you think about flipped classrooms as I make a recording of my lectures and I dump them on the intranet, that will not work. Students will not easily watch videos of 1.5 hours. Imagine yourself browsing YouTube. How often does it happen that you watch an entire YouTube movie of more than 1 hour? You should be very, very interested in the topic before you do that. That almost never happens. And the same is true for your students. If you have small pieces of 5 or at most 10 minutes, that is something they will easily watch one by one, but not the long piece. Avoid the long piece. Try to search tasks that are not too easy, because then they just watch everything on automatic pilot, and not too complex, because, well, if nobody can solve the question, it's not very motivating. And that is where your capacity as a teacher comes in. Finding the right tasks, that is a very essential ingredient of flipping your classroom. Another mistake that I often heard people making is resist the temptation to re-lecture in the class. If you notice that they didn't make your reports, well, then really tell there is no lecture. Don't say, well, as there are no reports, I have no other choice than telling my story again here. If you do that, next week nobody will watch the videos anymore because they know they have a second chance in class. Resist that temptation. And a very practical but quite important one. As you require your students to submit their reports 24 hours before the lecture, well, you should not schedule that lecture on Monday morning. I did that once, and that's, you know, to what I spent my Sundays of that semester. Very easy, but you have to think about it well in advance before the schedule is organized. After you have done all this, does it help? What is the impact on the learning of your students? Personally, I'm teaching to moderate groups of 5 to 20 students, so I have not really statistically relevant data. But I have a lot of, well, intuitive data. I discussed a lot with my students. I observe how they reacted on the material. And if I compare courses that I have been teaching for 10 years in the traditional way with the same course, same material, but now flipped, I see an enormous increase in the deep understanding that the students have. The level of our discussions is not imaginable in the traditional class. This wall of silence, which I was always hitting, has completely disappeared. Perhaps it could happen in the past that with one particular bright student at the exam, we would have a discussion like this. But now we are having these discussions every week with the entire class. So I can't document that in hard numbers, but the effect is so clearly visible that I have not the slightest doubt that the learning of the students is much higher than it was before. What do the students tell themselves about it? I asked this to them in anonymous questionnaires and in colloquial discussions, and I will share with you a few things that emerge from these inquiries. One student formulated it in this way: I have been a student for 5 years now, and it never happened before that I was so well prepared for the exam, which is exactly the effect that we wanted to achieve. This student probably for the first time in his studying career did what everybody asked from them: digest your lectures week by week after the class. Well, once we asked them digest your lectures before the class, they effectively do it and they benefit from it. Something I was completely not expecting. It's very interesting. Many students indicate that they watch these videos more than once, some of them even up to 3 times. Can you imagine that? You are teaching and you tell them, well, if you want to hear the same lecture again, you can come again tomorrow, I will teach it again. Nobody will come. But if you give it as videos, they do that without asking it. They do it spontaneously. So no wonder that they learn more. They just spend more effort to it. This was an unexpected side effect that I think is very interesting. Also something I didn't think about, and the students of the first course I flipped rapidly found it out: it's very important that you advise your students to take notes when they watch the videos. Because if you are used to work with text material, once you have studied it, and for the exam you want to search a specific section, you can rapidly scan a written text and find the place where you want to be. With the video, that's not so easy. So if you don't make notes during watching the videos the first time, it will be hard to find the section that you want to refresh just before the exam. But if you give them that advice several times, repeat it several times, then students will find the will do that and they will feel this to be helpful. A somewhat more critical student was telling me, well, if you watch these videos at home, your thoughts can wander away rather easily. But he immediately added to that, actually in the class sessions, the same would happen. And there is no rewind button. So I still prefer the videos over the traditional lectures, was his conclusion. In the questionnaire that you got, there was really a lot of interesting material. And to finish, I pick out a few of the concerns that you raised in this questionnaire and try to respond on them here. One thing somebody mentioned was I'm a little skeptical about these flipped classrooms because all those videos can be boring for your students. I don't agree with that. If you flip your classroom in the way that I just described, the level of interest or how you call it in your videos is the same as in your lectures. If you have boring lectures, you will end up with boring videos. So then you should invest in making your lectures more interesting. But it's not a property of the videos as such that this could be felt as boring. Somebody said, well, I applied this method, but I don't use videos. All my preparation work is paper-based, text-based. And that's indeed true. You can perfectly imagine that you use a flipped classroom setting as soon as the printed book has been discovered. In the 19th century, you could have used this method. As soon as every student has the textbook available, you could flip. Why didn't it happen? Well, probably people tried, but they just noticed that it didn't work. Students don't make the preparations. So it's technology that helps to trigger students to make the preparations. The fact that you can offer this as audiovisual material, that helps a lot. The fact that you can watch this material not in a video recorder you have to install in the room of your in the living room of your parents' house. No, you can watch it on your individual laptop, on your individual phone. That kind of technology, that makes this method accessible. And in the same way, there is no objection of using text-based material as a preparation, on the condition that you enhance it with technology. And this is actually something I learned from your colleague Baren Thijs just half a year ago. We were discussing about these things, and he had a very powerful way to turn a text-based resource into a material for flipped classroom. I have tried it since then once for one lecture, and it works marvelously. You didn't invent it, but you pointed me in the right direction. So this is the people who invented it are at MIT. The website is called nbmit.edu, NB from Nota Bene. And what does that website does? What does that website do? It can accept any PDF that you upload to the website. You can share that PDF with your students. They can read their text-based preparation material in that website. And they can make annotations. The annotations they make directly on the PDF will appear at that right bar and will be visible to all of their colleagues. So you can start discussing with all your colleagues, with your entire class, starting from the text that everybody has to read. You can ask questions. You can answer questions of your fellow students. If the teacher wants to intervene in these discussions, that's possible as well. So the static text suddenly becomes a forum for discussion. Text-based preparation, but supported by this kind of technology. And in this way, you can flip a text-based course easily. Another comment. Somebody said, well, I tried these things and I got disappointed in blended learning and flipped classrooms. And also the students got disappointed because they feel that there is less interaction with their teachers. That's not what I felt. I feel that after flipping, I have much more interaction with my students. If you are lecturing, it often happens that there is a one-way flow of information. You are together in the same room, but you can't call that interaction. In a discussion session after the flipped preparation, we are really interacting with each other. And indeed, I have cut my class session time by a factor of 3 even, where there were 3 lectures before, there is only one of them. And in that sense, there are less contact hours, as we call it. But the quality of the contact has increased so much that I feel that really the interaction with the students is higher now than it was before. Another comment was, In my opinion, flipping is not the solution. It needs to be combined with many other teaching innovations. And I completely agree with that one. No single teaching method is the solution, because your students will always be different, your courses will be different. So you have to make your personal mix of methods, and it's only that mix that will be the solution. Flipping can be part of that. Somebody who thinks economical said, well, whatever is the value of flipped classrooms or any other teaching innovations, the traditional lecturing will always remain the most cost-efficient one. With one salary, you serve 200 students. I don't completely agree, because the kind of flipping that I described, these four steps, is something that doesn't take more lecturers than it took before. So it's still one lecturer that can serve these 200 students, but in a more effective way. So in this way, flipped classrooms are cost the same as traditional lecturing, but their efficiency will be higher. I would like to confront that opinion with something someone else added to the questionnaire, somebody who was in search for ideas for distance learning. Well, once you have made this flip, suddenly distance learning becomes much more easy. We are trying this as a kind of experiment right now in a course that has started this week, a course that has been flipped previous year. And this term, we will teach it as usual in Ghent University. But a number of students will take the same course from different continents. Students from Argentina, from India, from China. They will have access to the same video material. They will submit their reports at the same deadline as the other students, the Ghent students. And when we have this weekly class session, we organize it at 1 in the afternoon, which is early morning in Argentina and still evening in China. So it's an accessible window for everybody. By a simple Skype live stream, they will attend the class session as well. And in this way, one salary is serving four continents at once, without extra effort, without even extra investment. So I cannot tell you numbers yet. I cannot tell you whether that worked or not, but we're trying this right now. And the last remark is actually my summary. Somebody of you made a statement, if flipping is done in the right way, then I'm convinced it's very effective. And I hope that with the inspiration that I try to give you here, you can find what is the right way for you to try this flipping also for yourself and for your students. Thank you.